हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू ऑनलाइन कोर्स ऑफ मैकेनिकल मेजरमेंट एंड मेट्रोलॉजी। माई सेल्फ अभिषेक त्रिवेदी फ्रॉम मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट एट एलजे इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी। इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी हैव कंप्लीटेड अवर चैप्टर ऑफ इंटरमीडिएट सर्किट, इंटरमीडिएट मॉडिफाइंग एंड टर्मिनेटिंग डिवाइसेज एंड द एडवांसेज इन द मेट्रोलॉजी, इन विच वी हैव कवर्ड द टॉपिक नेम्ड एज कोऑर्डिनेट मेजरिंग मशीन। We have discussed the constructional features of the coordinate measuring machine, how it will work, how we have also seen the basic procedure to drill the holes in the two different spots by using the linear dimensioning systems, and then we have discussed the basic application of the CMM. Today we are going to start our new chapter. The name of the chapter, that is the force, torque, pressure, strain and temperature measurement. All the elements, let's say force, torque, pressure, strain and temperature, all these five elements are very different and are very useful in the mechanical industries. Without force, without torque, without pressure, strain and temperature, no any mechanical setup has been performed properly. So it is very much required to measure each and every dimensions of the particular mechanical industries with proper precision, with proper accuracy. So to measure all these elements, we have designed a lot of instruments. We have started with the very conventional instrument, and then we are move on to the very advanced instruments which are directly useful, which are directly applicable to the mechanical setup, and they can calculate the values of the force. Let's say they can calculate the values of the torque, they can calculate the values of the pressure, strain and temperature measurements. So it is very much required for an engineer to understand all this particular concept and how we are supposed to measure all these particular elements of the measuring mechanical setup. Today we are starting with the measurement of the force. We are going to discuss the introduction of the force, the basic classification of the force and the classification of measuring instrument in terms of force. Then we are, in upcoming lecture, we are going to discuss each and every element step by step, one by one. So let us start with the concept of the force. First of all, what do you mean by force? Before understanding the measurement of the force, you are supposed to know that is the, what is the concept of the force, what is the basic definition of the force. I can say that the force can be defined as the cause that produce the resistance or the obstruction to any moving body, or change the motion of the body, or tends to produce the effect, is known as a force. Suppose the body is at the rest. Suppose this is a body which is at the rest condition. I am providing some effect due to which the body will start moving in the direction. Suppose the body is already moving in the direction. I am providing some effect, the body will change the direction of the motion. Or any of this effect or any of the parameter which generate or which has a tendency to generate such kind of effect, the effort applied, or we can say the reason behind this, is known as a force. Which particular reason is there to change the motion, to change the direction, or to change the position of the body, this particular reason is known as a force. Force usually measured by applying it to the calibrated devices which can resist the force and indicate or record the magnitude of the force. The unknown forces can be measured by the two methods. The first one, that is a direct method of measurement of the force, and second one, that is an indirect method of measurement of the force. In the direct method of measurement of the force, we are simply comparing the forces with the unknown values, and then we are going to measure the force. In the indirect method of measurement, we are comparing the force but with some different parameters, and then we are calculate the value of the force. Let us start with the basic measurement of the force. In the first direct method of measurement, in the direct method of measurement, you can say it is a basic comparison method of measurement. The unknown force is directly compared with the gravitational force acting on it, compared with the gravitational force acting on the known mass, is known as a direct method of measurement of the force. Let's say M is equal to mg. Whereas in the indirect method of measurement of the force, what we are supposed to do, we are comparing the forces. Yes, we are also comparing the forces, but we are indirectly comparing the forces. So it is known as a indirect comparison method of measurement in which the unknown forces is converted into the another physical quantity by conversion element, and which is easily measurable, and then that particular physical quantity is going to be measured. What we are supposed to do, we are simply converting the force into the another parameter, and which parameter, the particular parameter is easily readable, is easily measurable. We are converting the force into those particular parameters, and then we are simply measuring those particular parameters with very easiness. So this is the basic concept of the direct and indirect method of measurement of the forces. Now let us start with the basic measuring instruments for the measurement of the force. The first one, that is the analytical arm balance, or we can say equal arm balance. Suppose I have to measure the weight of, let's say, 5 kg. Then what I'm going to do, I will simply take a pen balance, a balance arm. The unknown weight has been placed at the distance d from the main pivot point. What I'm supposed to do, I will provide the known weight. Suppose this is unknown mass, I will provide the known mass over here. I will simply increasing the value of the mass, let's say 1 kg, then 2 kg, then 3 kg, 4 kg, 5 kg, 6 kg, and so on at the same distance d. In the initial case, this particular balance arm will be acted like this. Then once we are increasing the value of the mass over here, slowly and steadily the arm will try to coming in the horizontal position. This will start moving in the upward direction. Once the arm will achieve its original horizontal position, then what we are supposed to do, we are simply check that how much mass has been placed in the another pen, and then we are accepting that the particular known mass is equal to unknown mass. We are simply comparing the value of the mass. This is known as an analytical balance or equal arm balance. In the routine vegetable shops, in the routine jewelry shops, in the routine all the kind of shop where we are using the basic conventional pen balance, or we can say we are using conventional weight balance, those all weight balance are known as an equal arm balance, or we can say analytical balances. Unequal arm balance. In the equal arm balance, there is a drawback. The drawback is that for all the unknown mass, you are supposed to provide the same amount of the known mass over here. Till 5 kg, let's say 10 kg, 15, 20, it is okay. But suppose you have to find the value of 5000 kg, then it is compulsory that you have to place the 5000 kg over here, and it is not physically possible. So what we have done, we are supposed to use the concept of momentum. Suppose this is the distance 1 and the distance 2. If the weight is hang over this, let's say that is a 5000 kg at the distance of 1 meter, then what I am supposed to do, I will simply increase the distance, let's say 10 meter, and I will reduce the total weight requirement, that is the only 500 kg, just because of balancing the moment at the pivot point. So by increasing the arm length, you can easily reduce the requirement of the weight as the known mass weight to calibrate, or we can say to calculate the value of the unknown mass weight. To do so, we are using the unequal arm balance. The figure shows the basic concept of the unequal arm balance, how we can use. As you can check from the figure, the pivot point has two different length L1 and L2. From the length, the pen which is attached at the distance L1 from the main point, we are simply providing the unknown mass, and the opposite side we are simply providing the known mass. Just because of increasing the length, we are supposed to require the very less amount of the mass over here instead of this, and we can easily measure the value of the mass. So guys, this is the basic concept of the equal arm balance and unequal arm balance, or we can say analytical balance and unequal arm balance. Then the next topic for the measurement of the forces, that is the pendulum scale. The figure shows the basic concept of the pendulum scale and how the scale has been work, how the scale is useful for measurement of the particularly weight. First of all, let us understand the constructional details of the pendulum scale, and then we are going to discuss the working of the pendulum scale. The scale itself having a simple frame. I will draw the structure with a very simple formation. This is the frame. At the end of the frame, we have a routine conventional bar. The bar is attached with the vertical setup. The setup has a rack profile. Now you know the what is the rack profile. Rack profile is the infinite gear setup. The bar is attached with the sector. Suppose this is the sector. Same way on the opposite side, we are supposed to find sectors. The sectors are pivoted on the bar. Then a routine conventional point pinion has been attached, and the pinion at the end of the pinion we have the pointer, and the pointer is directly attached with the scale. The weight is placed over here, the dead weight, let's say W, with a known mass is placed over here to maintain the position of the sectors. A strip has been extended, and below the strip there is a platform provided on which the routine weight has to be placed. This is the platform. You can place the unknown mass over the platform, and the structure has been hung on the hanger. This is hang on the surface. This is on the surface, it is hang. This particular strip, this is the metal strip which attaches the platform. The strip is directly turning inside the particular sector and attached with the pivot bar. Again, this particular will directly moving inside the sector and attached with the pivot bar. This is the basic structure of the pendulum scale. Now what is happening? Suppose in the very first case the platform is empty, then there is a tendency that the sector will slightly move inside, slightly bent inside due to the, its own mass, own weight. So we are providing the dead weight over here to maintain the zero condition of the sector, and the pointer shows the zero value. Once the weight has been placed over the platform, the platform will start moving in the downward direction slightly, and due to the downward motion of the platform, that we can say that the metal strip or the strip which is directly attached with the platform will start moving in the downward direction. Once it is start moving in the downward direction, it is also has a tendency to rotate the sectors in the particularly inside direction. It has a tendency to rotate the sector. Let's say sector is moving inside the direction. Once it is moving inside the direction, the sectors are pivoted at the bar. The bar itself having the tendency to move downward direction. Remember, the sector are making a partial rotation, whereas the whole bar setup, whole assembly will move in the slightly downward direction. The rack is directly attached. The rack is directly attached to the bar. So if bar will start moving in the downward direction, the rack will also moving in the downward direction. And the pinion is attached with the rack. Then if the rack is moving down, the pinion will start rotating in the single directional motion. And due to the rotation of the pinion, the pointer which is rigidly connected with the pinion is also moving in the direction, single direction. And we can check the difference on the scale. The scale is directly calibrated to the unknown mass. Then by using this particular setup, we can measure the value of the unknown mass. From the figure you can check here the load pull, here the pull P has to be attached, then the rack and pinion attachment, scale, pivot, support taps are there, equalizer bar is there, frame, sectors, and the dead weight, or we can say counter weight, is provided. Here this is the loading taps, and loading taps is used to transfer the motion, or we can say loading tap is used to transfer the particular effect of the load from the unknown loading platform to the sector, and from the sector to the equalizer bar, and from the equalizer bar to the rack, and from the rack to the pinion, and pinion will directly transfer the effect on the motion of the pointer. And once the pointer will start moving, we are supposed to check it on the calibrated scale, and by using the calibrated scale you are supposed to find the value of the weight which is placed on the platform of the unknown mass. This is the basic case of the pendulum scale. So guys, this is the basic case of the pendulum scale. Now we are going to discuss spring scale. As the name suggests, in the spring scale what we are supposed to do? We are simply using F is equal to kx. We are using this particular equation where F, that is the mass which is placed below the spring scale, k, that is the spring's constant, and x, that is the deflection of the spring. Suppose we are using a conventional spring, then we know the value of the k. We know what is the total displacement or what is the total deflection generated inside the spring. Then by multiplying these two factors, we are supposed to find the value of F, how much force is attached to the hanger, and what is the basic weight which is directly connected to the spring scale. In the particular spring scale, a rigid support is provided. Below it, the springs has to be given. In the particular spring scale, a rigid support has been provided. Below it, the springs has been given. Then the hook and the hanger has been provided. And below the hook and hanger, we have the unknown weight platform is there, on which we are supposed to provide the unknown weight. From the vertical scale, you can check the deflection of the spring, and by using, or we can say by checking the deflection of the spring. From the vertical scale, you can check the deflection of the spring, and by checking the deflection of the spring, you are supposed to find the value of the x, let's say in mm. You know the spring's constant in Newton per mm, then simply you are using the equation F is equal to kx, where k in Newton per mm into x in the mm. Mm get cancelled, you are supposed to find the value in the Newton. We are simply find the value of the force which is directly attached to the spring scale. So guys, this is a very basic concept of the measurement of the forces. Here we are supposed to wind up our lecture. What we have discussed today, we have started with the basic concept of the force, how the force can be defined. Then we are supposed to classify the force measuring instrument in the two different methods, like indirect method of measurement and the direct method of measurement. Then we have discussed the equal and unequal arm balances, and then we have completed our lecture with the completion of the theories of pendulum scale and the spring scale. From next lecture, we are going to discuss the load cells, which are also useful and which are widely useful mechanical measuring instruments for measurement of the forces. These all instruments what we have discussed today are a very basic instrument which are useful in the local market, but in the mechanical industries we are not supposed to use all such instruments. We are using load cell for measurement of the forces. Those load cells we are going to discuss in the upcoming lectures. Till then, thank you.